Hey, hey, it's Tamara here. Welcome to the second episode of my tutorial series about making a farm simulator in Unity. You may as well know it as making HayDay. In this episode, you will see how to make a shop system with object dragging exactly like in the game, and also switching tabs. And the truth is, it will be even better than in the actual game because we will do some optimization. Interested? Continue watching. First thing first, I'd like to tell you about new things that I have recently discovered about the HayDay game. So, remember I said that the game was clearly made in 2D space? The thing is, it is not entirely true as it turned out. I came across a video from the official HayDay channel where they showed how they made a pasta maker machine. It shows that the 3D model is made for that building. I guess you'll need a bit of an explanation on this. The game is mostly 2D, but in order to animate things, the developers made the buildings 3D. There is another video showing how the decorations are made, and they're just flat sprites. This approach is widely seen in isometric games to achieve a detailed look, but also to make the animations easier. If you haven't seen my video about isometric view in games, go check it out, because you can't make an isometric game without that info. I would say that HayDay is more a 2D game than 3D. Even the objects are drawn so that they seem flat. Don't worry, we will not change the type of project we're making. It's still going to be 2D. The reason I will continue making the project in 2D is that it is easier for us to make in Unity. HayDay team used their own engine, which is probably more suitable for this type of isometric view. If we were to choose 3D, we would lose access to a convenient feature of isometric tile maps, and handling 2D plus 3D graphics would become more complicated. I hope that clears things up for you and we can continue with the tutorial. Let's look at the shop system that we're going to make in this episode. In HayDay, the shop slides from the left. We also have tabs on the side. There are 5 of them for different types of objects. We will cover tabs in this video and you can even use them in your other projects. Getting objects on the map in HayDay is something that I consider significant. Other games of this genre have a different system when you click on an item and get it placed on the map somewhere in the middle. This game features dragging from the shop onto the map. I think this is not the only game which does this. I think I have seen similar shop system in PC games. I think dragging is actually HayDay's special thing because you plant by dragging crop, feed animals by dragging their food, etc. So, how would we approach this system? We will have a shop manager, which will handle populating the shop with items. And remember I said we will do some performance optimization for this system, so it's going to be better than in the original game. We will populate the shop only once, and then just enable and disable different objects when we switch tabs. In HayDay, every time you click on a tab, all the item holders are instantiated again. This can cause delays. In our case, switching between tabs will be instant. We will have a scriptable object for a shop item with all the necessary info to display and a shop item holder, which will be responsible for initialization of an item object. Also, we will have a simple script which handles object dragging. Before we look into the project, I just want to remind you that we're going to use the project that we created after the previous episode, so if you haven't watched it, you should do it now. Also, if you want to get the project right away, it is available on Patreon. This would be a great opportunity to get some extra content and support me so I can continue making these videos. Now, let's look at the UI we would need for this tutorial. We have a shop object which has a button and the actual shop holder as children game objects. Shop holder has a lot of other objects attached to it. First, we have a UI block. This is just an empty image with a defined size and zero alpha, so you can't see it. The purpose of it is to prevent player from clicking on other buttons, but also to make it possible to close the shop by clicking on the area. Then we have a text object for category tile. The truth is, I forgot to use it and change the text when I switch between categories, so you'll have to do it yourself. It is very easy, just make a field for it and set it every time you get a click on a different tab button. Tab button object has a vertical layout group to position the buttons evenly. You can set the parameters there like spacing and alignment of the elements. A button is just a background with an icon image. background is separated from the icon, so when a tab is active, the background is going to be different. Next, we have an item view object with an attached scroll view component. To make this, you need to create a scroll view object, remove the scroll bars, toggle the vertical scroll, because we don't need it to move horizontally. Then just rename mask object to tabs, add to content object vertical layout group, and a content size fitter. In the vertical layout group, you can set parameters like in the buttons object. In the content size fitter, you have to set the vertical fit to preferred size. Rename the object to tab and duplicate it 5 times. These will be our tabs with items. After this, we have a border collider, which is positioned right after the tab buttons, in order to detect if an object passes shop UI and gets to the world. It has a box collider 2D and a rigid body 2D. Collider should be a trigger, and rigid body has to have zero gravity. These components work fine for UI as well as for game objects. You just have to scale the collider a lot. As for the prefabs, we have an item holder, which has all the necessary info about a shop item like title, description, and price. We also have an icon image with an arrow which indicates that an item is available to drag. And we have the number of objects available to buy. And now it's time to write some code. Start by creating a few scripts. Shop manager, shop item holder, shop item drag, tab button, tab group. Also, before starting our work, import the LinkTwin asset from Unity Store. This is a tweening engine which I will be using for animation in this project, but in yours you can use another one if you like. Open the scripts in the editor. We will start with the shop item. First thing first, create an enum for object types. In this case, we will have 5 of them. Animal homes, animals, production buildings, trees and bushes, and decorations. Now, go up to the shop item class and write an attribute to create an asset menu. We have to specify the file name, menu name, and order in the list. Now, I made a few mistakes when writing this, which I corrected later, but you should do this now. In the menu name, there shouldn't be a gap between words of the category, but not in the name of the menu. Correct version is on the screen. And also, make the shop item inherit from a scriptable object. Now, back to the video. Create properties for an item. They will store the information about it. You have seen them on the item holder, so no need to repeat. We also have a prefab field, which we will use later when we have a built-in system. The next script we're going to write is a shop manager. First, we create a static field for the current shop manager, since this class will be a singleton. After this, we have a static dictionary for currency sprites. We will use it when we need to display the amount we get or spend. Write a serialized field list of sprites to initialize the dictionary. Next, we have to save this object's transform and its parent transform and declare a bool opened. These fields will help us animate the shop. Create a serialized field for item prefab. Then create a dictionary with an object type key and a list of shop items. This is where we will store all our items and use it to populate the shop. Also, create a field for a tab group. In the awake method, we initialize current field with this and also initialize the transforms. In the start method, initialize currency sprites. When populating them in the editor, make sure you have the coin sprite first and crystal sprite second. Next, we're going to create a method which we will connect to the shop button. Save the animation time in a variable. Check if the shop is not open. Then, if it is not, we call linTween moveX method and pass as parameter parent transform new position, which is the current position plus window size on x-axis and time. Set the bool to true and enable game object. In else, write the same line to move the transform, but we will subtract the window size and set function on complete to disable the object. Set the bool to false. Also, in the start method, we have to disable the window, so the tab buttons are not visible at the beginning. You can do it in the editor too, I just preferred it this way. Now, in the editor, add shop manager script to the shop holder object and connect the shop button to the method we just created. We can test it now. The shop slides forward and backward, and we can move on to the next thing. Now, we will set up an optional feature when you can close the shop window by clicking anywhere not on the shop UI. but I also want to prevent closing when a player is dragging and not clicking. I create a bool dragging, then in the method onBeginDrag set this bool to true. onEndDrag set the bool to false, and finally in the method onPointerClick we call the shopButton method if we're not dragging. Go to the editor and add an event trigger component to UIBlockGameObject. Add events for beginDrag, endDrag and pointerClick. Initialize them with our methods. We can test this in the editor, but since you can see the cursor, it would look the same. Back to our shop manager script. Create a load method. Here we will load all shop items from the resources and populate the dictionary with them. Before doing this, don't forget to add all types of objects to the dictionary. After this, create a method initialize where we will populate the shop. We don't have the necessary fields for this, so we will have to come back to it later. Call the load method and initialize method in the start. We also have to make sure that new items are unlocked once new level is reached, so create a method onLevelChanged which accepts event information of LevelChanged game event, which we created in the previous episode. Go over each item in the shop items dictionary like we did in the initialization, but this time check if the level of an item is the same as new level and unlock it. Add this method as a listener to the event in the awake method. Now go to the editor and create a few shop items. Right click in the folder, find game objects and then shop item. Now it's time to take care of our shop tabs. Open the tab group script. Create two sprite fields for an idling tab and active tab. Then create a list of tab buttons and a list of game objects to swap. Create a field for the selected button. Create a method to subscribe a button to this tab group. It will only add a button to the list. We also need to create a reset method which will set backgrounds of buttons to idling, if they are not selected, of course. You can see that the background field is red and that's because we haven't created it. Next, create a method onTabSelected which accepts a tab button as a parameter. Assign selected tab, reset the buttons and set the background to active. Now we have to swap active objects. Get the index of our selected tab button. In a loop, if the indexes match, set an object to active. If not, disable that object. Call this method onStart and pass the first button to it. Now open the tab button script. Before the declaration of this class, write an attribute to require an image component. Then make the class implement the interface IMPointerClickHandler. Create a field for a tab group. Create a public non-serialized field for the background image. Initialize it in the awake and subscribe the button to its tab group. Implement onPointerClick method. Call the tab group onTabSelected and pass this button. Go to the editor and attach tab group script to tab buttons object and tab buttons to their objects. Initialize their fields. Test it in the editor. You can only see tabs buttons changing, but if we look at the tab objects, they are switching as well. Now, it is time to write the shop item holder script. In it, create a field for a shop item and also a bunch of fields for our UI elements. We will need an initialization method which accepts an item as a parameter and initializes UI elements with information about this item. If the level of an item is more or equal to the current level, we have to unlock this item. Create a method for it. We will add a shop item drag script to the icon image here and also set the arrow active. Go to your shop manager and call this unlock item method when a level changes. In the initialize method, instantiate the prefab, set the right tab object as parent and call the initialization on the shop item holder. Open shop item drag script. Implement interfaces for begin drag, end drag and drag handling. Create a static field for canvas. Create fields for rec transform, canvas group and image. Also, we will need to know the original position which we will store in a vector 3. Actually, it can be a vector too, because we only have x and y. And we need a bool drag. In the awake method, initialize the fields by getting the corresponding components. Say the original position. Implement method onBeginDrag. In it, set the bool to true. In the canvas group, set blocksRayCast to false and make the image not maskable. I accidentally wrote true, but it has to be set to false. In the onDrag method, add to the current position of this object the delta value which you get from event data divided by canvas scale factor. onAndDrag, do the opposite of what you did on beginDrag and also set the position to origin. Now, remember we created a trigger at the end of the shop UI? In this script we will detect trigger enter and call the shop manager button click. Also, I set the opacity of the image to 0 since I don't want the movement to be visible. To reverse this effect, create an onEnable method in which set the opacity back to 1. And also, copy the code from the onAndDrag method and paste it here. This will ensure that we have returned an item to its place and it will be ready to use next time. In the game manager script, initialize the canvas field for the shop item drag. We can also remove test methods from here since we don't need them anymore. Now, don't forget to add shop item holder script to the item holder prefab and populate all the fields. Notice that icon image has a collider added to it and a canvas group. They will be used to detect collisions and handle dragging respectively. Finally, we can test if everything works. We have a slide in shop, switch in tabs, an item drag which closes the shop if you exceed a certain point. Looks like we're done! So, what's next for this series? I'm planning on developing a building system which will work with our new shop system. We will do more work on the map, maybe talk about animations, etc. Stay tuned to see what comes next. Also, I wanted to ask you guys, what do you want to see in this series? I have already said that I would cover the basic systems that you can see in the game, but what do you think about such minor animations like shop sliding or XP flying to the XP bar? I can't always replicate them exactly because I don't have the same graphics and time is also an issue. Let me know in the comments if you like these tutorials and share your opinion about what I should develop next. I'd like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, especially Stratus, Legatorus and Jay. Thank you for watching! Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and join the Discord server. You can discuss this and other projects there. See you soon! Bye!